We have some wonderful papers ahead, and we want our panelists to have as much time as possible. So please come on in, come and take a seat. Well, we welcome you today to one of the more salient and relevant topics that our guild addresses, and that is the topic of right-wing religion, politics, and environment in the U.S. Thank you. These are so good, aren't they? Wow. All right. Next, we have a presentation from Bernard Zaleha from Monterey Peninsula College, and his presentation is called Intense Apocalypticism, Collective Narcissism, and Hellfire Extremism Within the Calvary Chapel Movement, a review of new data revealing strong barriers to climate change concern. Okay, Bernie.
Greetings, everyone. Pretty much as soon as Lynn White declared that Christianity was largely responsible for current levels of ecological destruction in 1967, Christian thought leaders started mining the Bible and other parts of the tradition for environmentally friendly interpretations. There was a lot of excitement around this project. The late Peter Illian, a former Pentecostal pastor who participated in this project, beginning in the early 90s, by rereading the Bible with an ecological lens during a traverse of the Oregon portion of the Pacific Crest Trail with his llamas, he found in the Bible an environmentalist manifesto, a green gospel, and he believed that this new green gospel could make a real difference. In 1993, like-minded folks formed the Evangelical Environmental Network, primarily as an educational organization, to distribute environmental information to evangelical congregations. In 1996, it also joined a political campaign to help fend off Republican efforts in Congress to weaken the Federal Endangered Species Act. In the course of that campaign, Evangelical lay theologian and environmental studies professor Calvin DeWitt declared that the Federal Endangered Species Act was the Noah's Ark of our day, and that Congress and special interests were trying to sink it. As part of the campaign, DeWitt and other evangelical leaders organized a network of Noah congregations that pledged to oppose the congressional efforts to weaken the federal species protection. The campaign was successful, and evangelical participation was widely credited as a substantial factor in this victory. Among secular environmental advocacy groups, this victory created hope that new religious communities with the moral authority to make ethical demands for environmental protection were starting to emerge and just might break the long-standing political stalemate and increase public demand for climate action and environmental protection generally. So far, a quarter century on, this has not happened to any significant degree. Indeed, if anything, liberal Christianity is largely inactive, and evangelicals have become the foot soldiers for advancing anti-LGBTQ policies and a militant forced birth theofascism. After a 17-year career as an environmental litigator, I returned in 2006 to grad school, hoping to investigate this disappointing result. First down at the University of Florida in the discipline of religious studies, and then at the University of California, Santa Cruz in the Sociology of Religion and Environmental Studies departments. For my dissertation research, I sought to investigate why Christian environmentalism seemed to have amounted to so little. Between 2015 and 2018, I did field work in congregations in Arizona and California. I divided my visits between a fundamentalist confederation of churches known as the Calvary Chapels and liberal congregations affiliated with the Center for Progressive Christianity. I interviewed pastors, church members, and key leaders within religious environmentalism and conducted focus groups, including two just a few miles from here, one in Phoenix and one in Mesa. I attended many potlucks, coffee hours, community dinners, thereby engaging in a type of participant observation research. Mostly, though, I just went to church every Sunday for about 4 years, starting in 2014 and most intensively from May 2016 to May 2018. To see and hear contemporary Protestantism in person. Between Sundays, I listened to countless sermons of Calvary Chapel pastors, thanks to their practice of creating massive online archives of their sermons. When I was personally in the church setting, I mostly observed and asked non-triggering, innocuous questions. I found substantial indifference or outright hostility to environmental concerns and climate mitigation in all my Calvary Chapel sites. Today, due to time constraints, I am limiting myself to discussing just my Calvary Chapel sites and these particular observations and findings. Number one, chapelers have internalized an intense apocalyptic end time belief in the imminent rapture, followed by 7 years of tribulation, and in turn followed by the supernatural destruction of planet Earth. Given that these end time events could begin literally any second now, any concern about climate crisis, mass extinction, or any other environmental problem is, at best, a tragic distraction. Number two, chapelers believe that saving people from eternal punishment in hellfire is their primary responsibility. Number three, chapelers experience an emotionally charged and pleasurable collective narcissism binding them to the chapler movement and its anti-environment and anti-queer ideology. This collective narcissism is built into the very structure of their theological beliefs. Number four, there are several other aspects to evangelical theology and metaphysics that, in combination with these just listed factors, serve to create a near absolute barrier to any climate change or environmental concern within the overwhelming majority of the chapler social community. Indeed, over the course of 3 years, I did not find any parish members or their pastors or elders who would acknowledge any environmental concern or responsibilities, save one thing: evangelicals shouldn't litter. That's it. Given my very limited time here today, I cannot elaborate much on these findings. However, over the past year at two conferences and in my response to Dr. Veldman's lecture at the University of Florida this past April, I have elaborated each of these factors in much more detail. If you are interested, you can search my name on YouTube. Today I will expand a bit more on the collective narcissism that I observed. The concept of collective narcissism was conceived by the social psychologist Agnieszka Golic de Zabala and her various collaborators, who have developed and empirically investigated this phenomenon over the last decade. Inspired by the work of Theodore Adorno, Wilhelm Reich, and Eric Fromm, they theorized that individual narcissism, which is an excessive self-love, or inflated, grandiose view of oneself that requires continual external validation might also find expression as collective narcissism. They hypothesized that if people can be narcissistic about their personal identities, they can also be narcissistic about their collective identities. This phenomenon helps explain the emotional payoff some evangelicals receive for their devotion to a form of theologically conservative American Christianity, which teaches its adherents that they are piously superior to everyone outside the community, which teaches God loves them most. Indeed, they are going to be rewarded by God with eternal pleasure and bliss, while the same God consigns the overwhelming majority of all humans who have ever lived to eternal torture. Chapler pastors frequently weave declarations of this moral superiority into their sermons. Evangelicals are superior, not because they behave better or perform better deeds. Indeed, one chapler pastor who had been preaching a sermon on Romans 1 told me afterwards that adultery and pornography use are severe problems in evangelical churches. No, their moral superiority comes from not their behavior, but from their right belief. On more than one occasion, one of the chapler pastors I observed and would, chapler pastors I observed would preach on the importance of being, quote, intolerant towards those with wrong beliefs, even though intolerance is frowned upon in the larger culture. After one of his sermons, the same pastor explained to me that this was why he doesn't like being in the presence of environmentalists, because anyone with undue concern about the environment obviously has the wrong beliefs. However heady these feelings of group importance and moral superiority may be, they can be nevertheless unstable and fragile. Thus, isolating oneself from the larger society as much as possible, according to this pastor, becomes an important defense. Even he acknowledged in one of his sermons that he too struggles with doubt, and that the solution is to always cling to faith. Peter Illian, who I mentioned above, did not use the term collective narcissism when I interviewed him in October 2016. He did, however, describe a very similar and analogous evangelical trait, the narcissism of personal piety, he called it. He noted that he had seen this intensify during the three decades of his activist career. Describing contemporary evangelicals, Illian declared, quote, good works aren't a requirement. Works don't matter. It's what I believe that matters. If sociology as a discipline has any one overarching insight, it is that there seems to be no upper limit on what a particular person or group of persons will believe if someone else has the temerity to simply say it. There might be some outer boundary to the believable, but I don't think the social sciences have yet discovered such a boundary. Indeed, if anything, human credulity seems to be expanding in every possible direction. I have in mind the exploding number of conspiracy theories like QAnon, Pizzagate, various forms of election denialism, and that climate change and COVID-19 pandemic are just hoaxes created by greedy academics as part of a scheme to get research grants. William and Dorothy Thomas taught us nearly a century ago in their now famous theorem, if people, quote, define situations as real, they are real in their consequences, end of quote. Beliefs become a real internal mental reality, and these beliefs may be, and often are, acted upon by the believers. Indeed, they can become a totalizing framework, dictating the whole life course of members in a particular human community, which in turn may affect literally all the rest of us. I contend that collective narcissism that inheres in present-day evangelicalism, along with the other factors I couldn't discuss today, is yet one more type of cognitive quicksand that makes environmental concern in these communities a near impossibility. Thank you.
Okay, wow, this is amazing. I now invite us into some Q&A. Wow, there's just so much to dig into in this panel. I've got the microphone so that people who are tuning in virtually can also listen to us. So, who wants to start us off? Okay.
Okay, so I don't have to shout. Okay, I got that out of my system.
I know, right?
Thank you guys so much. Yeah, this was awesome and really horrible. And I just wondered whether you have to wash and bleach after you dig into this research. But the specific question, actually, was just curious about Bernie's research. And how does the stuff that you found among your particular collection of evangelical Christians match up against evangelical Christians who are now embracing creation care?
I mean, I think that, you know, we can argue about how representative are the chaplers of white or evangelicalism in general. However, I think that the best example that the chaplers are pretty representative would be having been presented to us courtesy of the example of Donald Trump. You know, in 2015, when he came down the golden escalator, nobody thought he had any kind of a chance. Then it turned out he did, in fact, have a chance to win the nomination, but nobody thought he could win the general election, but he did. And exit polling and the Pew did, very careful surveys of that 77% of white evangelical parishioners supported Trump and were very excited about him. Now, I think probably most people in this room experienced 4 years of a Trump presidency and thought, okay, everybody now understands this was a huge mistake. But no, amongst white evangelicals, the support for Trump in his 2020 reelection went up. They said, man, we've seen 4 years and we'd like some more of that. And so I think that probably tells us that it's certainly amongst white evangelicals that the chaplers are probably pretty representative.
Okay.
I'm really interested in the role of younger conservative Christians in this conversation, and if the messages are also getting to them. A lot of you had mentioned PragerU, and I would just be wondering, I'm just interested in terms of like how that's manifesting itself, particularly as younger generations are coming up in a world that's more diverse and in some cases more open to certain things, thinking like gay marriage and whatnot. So how are they interacting with this conversation?
During my period of research, I was kind of actively looking for any signs that I was aware that there was the young evangelicals climate action movement that was specifically designed to reach 30 people 30 and under by the ENN. They decided they needed a youth element. And in the course of my research, you know, it's certainly when I was out observing, I just didn't see any sign. Maybe one anecdote, you know, I was sitting at a dinner table, and there was one young person there, and I just kind of picked up a vibe because I asked the question, do you know of anybody in your congregation that has any concern about climate change? And he kind of seemed like he was being consciously not answering the question. Like maybe if he did, he'd say something that would get him in trouble with his community. But when I was interviewing one of the co-founders of the Young Evangelical Climate Action, I said, so do you feel like the folks in your movement of young evangelicals are kind of ready to accept the recognition that if you're gonna accomplish anything on climate action, it means you're gonna have to start voting for pro-choice Democrats? And this guy who'd been involved in founding this network of young evangelicals just seemed shocked that I would even suggest that being concerned about climate change might mean he would have to start changing his political behavior. So, you know, to me that was a very sad finding that I found in this interview with somebody founding an evangelical climate action movement.
Yes. Are we out of time?
My question just kind of deals with how, I guess, the environment is being constructed as not sacred, you know. There was another session earlier where the mediation was going towards nature as sacred, but this seems to be like deconstructing that. So I was kind of wondering how you saw the sacred being constructed deconstructed in these discourses.
Bernie, you had also a comment.
I just wanted to quickly go back to the last question.
Sure.
On how a chapler evangelical would, you know, respond to the question of the sacredness of the earth. And indeed, biblically, I mean, if we want to look at one biblical passage that is cited, it was cited every time an anti-environmental attitude was justified biblically, it was Romans 1:25, where the Apostle Paul says, thou shalt only worship the Creator and never the creation. And so, indeed, the idea of being concerned about the creation, you know, is one of the things that showed you were spiritually in peril. So in terms of how they justify the, you know, justify their attitude that nature is very specifically not sacred, you know, that would be the verse they would, you know, turn to over and over and over again.
Okay, we have 3 minutes left, so does anybody have a quickie, as it were? No? Okay, well, thank you all so much. And please thank our panelists once again for four really, really strong presentations, hopefully coming soon to a publication near you. Thank you all. We're on to the next session.